Sure.
Cool.
Yeah, we can do that.
So you guys are a long way from home.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You've come to Newport Beach with your child. Yes. Was that something that you, was that your plan when you made this movie, that you'd end up coming to places like Newport Beach? And
No, it's really one of the great perks.
We didn't really know the outcome, I don't think so. Mm. We didn't know whether we'd get it. We didn't have a plan for any kind of festivals in particular. We just really wanted to make what we wanted to make and just hope that people liked it.
Yeah, responded to it. I think it was always a plan to submit to a few festivals and hopefully, you know, get to show the film there and that. And it just, I mean, we were really fortunate with premiering at Santa Barbara, and and that was great. And then from there, Newport invited us, and it's really nice, especially being able to come back to California again as well, and then sort of, you know, hanging out here, you know, it's nice.
It was really cold last time we were here. Now it's really warm. Everyone's talked about, our whole lives about LA weather, and finally.
Now you know the truth.
Now we know what it's
really like. Yeah, now we're going, okay, yeah, get it, yeah. Mm.
So was there a plan when you started? I mean, was there a moment where you just said, hey, let's make a movie?
Yeah.
Let's put on a show in the barn.
we were actually going to buy a house, and we were very close to buying a house, and I've been working in the movie industry for a long time, and so had Inge, and we sort of looked at each other and said, well, I said, I don't want to make a house, I want to make movies. And Inge was like,
buy a house.
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
So, it's dramatic when you make a house.
Yeah. So I said, yeah.
Like you give birth to a house.
Yeah. So I was like, I don't want to buy a house, I want to make movies. And Inge said, I don't want to buy a house either, I want to make movies too. And so we thought, well, let's make a movie.
So
it took 6 years to do. So it wasn't like we were planning on coming to Newport Beach, but it was just a lucky part of it.
Well, I think what happened for us too is we'd actually put in three offers on houses and they all fell through. And driving away from the last one was where we both kind of looked at each other and just said, what are we doing? Why are we doing this? And because what we really want to do is make movies. And then from there, it instigated from there. But it was actually quite an organic process how it all really kicked off from there. It's not like sort of, that was draw a line in the sand, and then all of a sudden it was all, you know, on set the next day kind of thing. It was kind of like a real build up because
a lot of planning.
We did. Mike started writing the script, and we spent about three Christmases because we were both working full time at the time. Mm. We spent about three Christmases going down to the South Island doing location scouting, and you know, sort of quickly say hi to the family, and then go off and do location scouting.
Just to clarify, that's summer in New Zealand, so the Christmas break.
Yeah.
It's covered in snow. You can actually see what you're looking at. Yeah.
So we would go location scouting in that over that time, and that was three Christmases. So in during the time writing, developing the script, and then slowly starting to buy props, and you know, sort of like going little, like in all the little towns, we'd stop and go to the, like the secondhand store, and you know, get little things.
So it's kind of like buying a house and slowly furnishing it over 6 years.
Yeah, it's actually really similar.
Yeah, it was. So we did that, and then it's all sort of built up to we filmed in 2008, and then from there to post production, and that's when we actually, because up to the point of having the sort of a rough edit put together, Mike and I had been making it very independently, and then we got an independent investor on board, and amazing guy, and he helped us get over the finish line.
So did you go to KiwiMatch.com to find each other and tug off the part that said,
want to
don't
make
really
movies.
Want a house and make movies?
No, we've been together a while. Before we started, so.
So was movies always a thing with you guys and your kids, or did you fall into it as you got professional?
Well, no, these sort of individual stories, right?
Yeah.
I think.
There you go.
You weren't actually born in the same hospital next year.
No.
No, he's older.
Yeah, I'm older. What was the question?
Conveniently forgot. No.
Movies from childhood? I mean, were you a childhood movie obsessive, or did you?
No, I wasn't really. I had movies sort of come into my head, so to speak, when I was a teenager. So it wasn't when I was a child, but it was when I was a teenager, and I kind of tried to resist it for a while because the possibility of making films in New Zealand at that stage was really unlikely. Mm-hmm. Peter hadn't, you know, hadn't, the Lord of the Rings hadn't happened or any of that, so. It was quite an unrealistic option. But as I got older, I just decided that it was really what I wanted to do. It was really had to just embrace what I really wanted to do and get on with it. So
So what was it about movies that was so intriguing to you?
Well, there was two things. One was I kept having stories coming to my, you know, sort of, that's what I would focus on. That's I would spend a lot of my time, like, off. That's what I do, spending it. And also I think it's just, I guess I'm a person that likes to connect and communicate with people, or, you know, on some kind of level. And I think movies are great for doing that. I think they sort of say, hey, on some level, life to me is kind of like this. Do you think it's like that for you? And it's kind of basically a connection. That's my opinion. I don't know if I'm right, but and well, that's what appeals to me, I think. Mm-hmm.
Mm. And were you growing up thinking I want to be a damsel in distress?
Yes, I know. Well, yes and no. I think it's one of those things, because I think for a long time I also spent actually denying that that's what I wanted to do, mainly because it felt really cliched, you know, saying, oh, I want to be an actress. I don't know why. This is a real judgment in that statement that feels like that's what happens. But but I really actively really love that, you know, the exploration of just, you know, playing around with the truths of those moments, you know, and really connecting. And again, it's that real thing of being able to be on set and play. You know, and they create a scene of what, you know, what would be in real life and how that would all happen. But I think for me, what I did a lot of dancing when I was younger as well, and any sort of performing, I was really enjoying that that stuff, and it sort of leaped from one to the other. But I think film, specifically screen, is something that I've really responded to for a long time. And even when I was younger, I remember watching movies and just really kind of being mesmerised and. Yeah.
So when you decided not to buy the house and you're going to make a movie, when did Western come into mind?
I'd wanted to make a Western for a really long time, just because I grew up in the South Island of New Zealand, and in central Otago is where I spent my summer holidays, and I always felt a connection between the landscape there and the landscape of the Westerns, especially sort of, to some degree, more so the spaghetti Westerns from Italy and Spain. Mm-hmm. And I just always felt a real connection, and I thought, if Italy can do it, I mean, because the idea is that, you know, that with the Italian ones, they're shot, they're using Italian crews, but they're set in the American West, and I wanted to do the exact same thing. It's, you know, we're on the, like, the 43rd parallel.
Right.
Basically, the sort of inverse of the area, but at the other end of the planet, and it's got the same sort of feel about it when you look at the landscapes. And I would just always love Westerns.
So was that as easy as it looked in your head? Did you think, oh, this will be, you know, I know what I'm doing, and I've been around the business for a while, and let's go forward, and hey, yeah, let's
do Western. Easy.
I don't know if easy ever enters the realm of filmmaking. Challenging is the word that I'd use.
Yeah.
But not hard. I wouldn't say it's hard, it's just challenging. And I think there's a difference between the two. I think it's very enjoyable, no matter how difficult it gets. It was for us, for me anyway, yeah. But
I was just going to add, I was going to say actually about the Western and the landscapes. I think there was a conscious choice that we made about the fact that, you know, what those spaghetti Westerns managed to do was get so much production value out of the land. Mm-hmm. And so you can spend less on your, you know, your sets that you have to build and your, you know, explosions and cars that, you know, all that stuff. Like, using the landscapes for the production value in New Zealand, you know, they're free, you know, and they're stunning. And so that was quite a conscious choice that we made to really also utilise that. And,
I think so. And also, it hadn't been done before from New Zealand. So,
no sheep jokes in the entire movie.
No sheep jokes. No sheep in the entire. In fact, there was actually.
That took a lot of framing. Let's just say that.
There's actually one stage where we're out in the middle of nowhere, and there was a sheep skeleton on the ground, and the art department, Zoe Wilson, who was doing the art department, she grabbed the thing and she put it in shot, and I was like, no sheep in this movie.
Yeah, not even dead ones.
Not even dead ones.
And we did have one night shoot as well. I think it was at night. We were all sitting there and it's nice and quiet, you know, doing this thing. All of a sudden you just hear off in the background, there's this sheep going, man, and we're like,
Yeah.
No!
It was like four in the morning where this was yeah.
Make it go away.
There's always a sheep.
Yeah. I know.
So was there a moment where you knew it was real, it was actually going to happen? Or was there just when this person came out with the funding, or?
We had it finished by the time the person came on with the funding. I think finished the edit. The moment I guess we knew it was really going to happen, I mean, we had to think of creative ways right from the beginning to try and keep our costs down. So one thing we did was we built a trailer and filled it with every bit of conceivable equipment you can think of to make a movie. So we had like portaloos and cranes and dolly tracks and all the stuff that we made. Mm.
I love how the first thing out was a portaloo. Well, we made the movie.
And you made these?
not the portaloo.
No, we bought the
crane and the dolly and that.
How
sort
do you
thing.
Make a crane?
Well, his cousin is actually works at Weta Digital in the motion capture department. He's the stage manager and he's an amazing engineer, and he designed it and they built it together. And
so he didn't find a crane.
No, they made the crane. Found a dolly but made the crane. Or dolly tracks, I should say.
Well, you designed it, built it, got all the parts and knocked it together, and so they all fit in this. They all fit in this trailer, and we would go around. So that's where we sort of went around. But we didn't know if it would all work, really, because we sort of were on set by the time we could test any of it out. And we were on set one day. It was the first day of shooting, and it was a scene under a tree. And we went home at the end of, or back to the house. We rented a big house. Everyone just stayed in a big house. Mm-hmm. And we pulled up some of the shots, and it was sort of then that we knew it was going to work. Really, you could see that everything sort of had come together with the makeup and the costume and the locations and the lens choices and everything. So it was
quite a magic moment, because the
crew believed it too.
We
take them all the way down to South Island and they were like, the whole time.
It's going to work.
And then they're like, wow, it looks amazing.
Yeah.
It's like, of course it does.
Yeah, we're planning that.
Yeah.
it really happen that that moment was kind of, the DOP actually just threw a few of the shots together, and then we all sort of, everybody was sort of crowding around the laptop, you know, just Mac laptop, everybody looking at it. And we really had this moment where everybody sort of went, okay, we're good. This is working. Yeah. We're going to be okay.
It was a hard pitch saying we're going to make a Western in New Zealand. You know, people were like, but I knew the locations were there because I'd known since I was a boy. Mm-hmm. And I knew that the look would feel right. But it was just, when you're in Wellington, which is quite a different landscape. And going, it's going to be a Western, it's going to be great.
Yeah, they're like, really?
Like the spaghetti Westerns, you know, the Clint Eastwood ones, Good, the Bad, the Ugly, you know. And it's like,
so did you talk friends into doing it, or was it people who just were
a combination? It's a combination of stuff, because we've been fortunate with having worked in the film industry in Wellington for a number, well, I've been there about 6 years, and Mike was there for about nine before. And so what we're fortunate with is our friends. You know, if we go and call favors upon friends, they're actually, you know, really experienced, amazing people in the industry. Yeah. And so that's where I think we really, really were very fortunate with that. But then a lot of our crew are people whose first time out, or we would have people who, for example, our art director, she had done art department assisting, but she hadn't done art directing. Mm. And we were saying, well, look, you know, you're taking a punt on us, you know, we'll take a punt on you. You know, we believe in your talent, we believe in what you can do. And so there was a lot of that going on, where people were being given the opportunity to be able to do something that they really want to do, but they hadn't necessarily got that on their CV before or whatever. And so there's a lot of that we did. We really got young, new people on board, and because, you know, that's what we were, are.
Yeah. But we also combined that with guys that had a lot of experience. Our makeup artist had been working at Weta Workshop for a long time, doing the makeup there. And
yeah, he was on Lord of the Rings and all those.
And now, like, for example, the guy that did our saddles, he did a lot of the leather work for Lord of the Rings.
Our animal wrangler was also on the Rings, who'd done, you know, hundreds of horses on the Rings, and so he came on board. He was the first crew member on board, actually.
Yeah, because we knew it was horses.
Horses, he was like, yes, I'm in.
Yeah.
Well, is it a very tiny community, or has it grown to be? I mean, they always talk about shooting in Toronto, as there are, you know, three crews there, and there are two good, really good crews in Vancouver, and, you know, so there's there's something that's been created by people coming and shooting in Canada for enough times that there's now a crew there. Is it a really tiny group that does everything in New Zealand?
I think there is quite a tight group that focus a lot on films that are coming out of Stone Street Studios, like PJ's films or Avatar or that sort of stuff, and they're a pretty tight unit. But there's guys that are, there's quite a large number, like they're quite big crews on those films. I mean, mm-hmm. Hobbit, you know, they're big crews. So there's layers that are sort of coming up. So there's just depth to it, you know.
Yeah.
Whether you could say they're different sort of isolated crews, probably not. I wouldn't say they're isolated. Mm. It's sort of very interreactive, I think.
Yeah, and I think, and adding to that, that a lot of those shoots as well, they run for a very long time. So you'll have people sort of going through that system and, you know, moving up and then somebody else comes in or, you know, and so over the last 10 years, the New Zealand film industry has seen massive, you know, lengths of shooting and different, you know, so you've got all these people sort of gone through that film school now, you know, and or, you know, who came from overseas and are now settled in New Zealand.
Especially in the digital effects.
So we were very lucky. And then, you know, we were very lucky with Weta Digital being amazing as well, supporting us. There's 200 visual effects shots in the film.
Which is remarkable, actually, because you don't really see them. Which I guess is the idea.
Yeah, the best VFX you can't see.
Yeah. So they didn't actually do it, but they let us use their equipment, and our friends did it who worked there.
Right.
Well, you know, so.
Yeah.
So is it cleanup work, or is it, I mean, like, you know, there are 350-ish effect shots in Black Swan, and I think half of them, or more than half of them, are taking the lens out of the mirror.
Yeah.
But I mean, are you creating backgrounds primarily? What are the tricks?
There were backgrounds, there were arrows, there were little bits. There was an occasional fence post and things like that. Or a power pole
in the background. You know, we basically framed it. When we did location scouting, we were really strict about, having worked in visual effects for a long time, we were very strict about not saying the words, "we'll fix it in post." We were really strict about that.
But it came up pretty quickly, to be honest.
Yeah, it came up very quickly. We'll fix it in post.
We did blood splatters and sort of extra smoke layers and things like that.
So you went in not expecting to do that so much at all? Was that part of your plan ever?
Well, just being at Weta for a long time, and the best effects are always the ones that are done in camera and the effects work as a supplement. And so that was the focus. So, for instance, I became the armourer of the film. Mm. So I spent a year getting my armourer's licence, but that was because I really wanted to have the right guns.
We went all out.
That is like insane committed to something.
Yeah.
I became an armorer.
Do you know how much armor is charged?
Armor is a really expensive.
It's a good gig, yeah.
Yeah.
That, you know, I wanted the old guns and do all the research on the old guns and get the right, like, big levels of gun smoke and things like that so that we wouldn't have to have much if we did. It's just to fill it out, but we could shoot it all in camera.
So did you spend a year doing anything else on this project? Did you, you know, become a costumer for a year and a half? Or
we became editors for a while.
Doing some editing for a while.
Yes.
Which you had played with before, or you kind of dove into feet first?
On short films and things like that. But, you know, it's a bit of a different beast to get the whole arc of a feature film. So, but we had other people come on board. We had Greg Daniels come on in the end and really finish the edit for us and do a great job. So,
and our executive producer, he's Jamie Selkirk, who won the Oscar for editing Return of the King, and also one of the owners of Weta and that. And he, we actually showed him early on. Well, after we'd had a rough cut together, we showed him mainly to get some editing notes, and from there, you know, he had some really great notes, and we were chatting away, and from there, everything sort of grew over time with him being involved with the project, and then eventually...
Well, he introduced us to Greg Daniels
and
got him to come to finish the edit.
And then eventually he came on board to help us take it over the finish line. And then we, you know, we had amazing sound mix that we did at Park Road Post, which is Peter Jackson's facility, and we got to do the full, you know, the great sound guys who worked on all his films.
And then the New Zealand Symphony Orchestra came on board.
Which, another one, like... Did you have extra money in the budget for the symphony orchestra that you were going to...
We actually called them up and we went,
Hey, guys.
And we had a little trailer cut and we went there and we had some photographs and they just loved the look of the film. They thought it was brilliant and they liked the potential of it. And they decided to come on at a very, 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 very generous rate. And then it was a case, things sort of started to become serious. We got John Sarthos on board, who's the composer, and he composed music for the opening and closing ceremonies for the 2004 Athens Olympics. And he hadn't made a movie, he hadn't done a film school before. He had been asked, but he didn't want to. He sort of hadn't found a project that he liked. And he watched the film and he just fell in love with it. And he was like, I want this to be my first film score. I love this film and I can bring something to it. And so... which was awesome because he's got a mess. Yeah. He's got a big following sort of overseas as well.
And he's extremely talented.
Yeah, he's a really talented composer. So things started to become serious, and we needed some money to really finish it. And we were broke because we just shot.
Shot a feature film.
Yeah.
And, you don't only not want to buy a house. You don't ever want to buy a house.
Yeah.
So do you? I mean, does that hammock of support that shows up, is that something that encouraged you to make a film like this, or is it something that was, thank God it was there when you needed it, and you know, it all kind of came together?
All of the above.
Do you think it inspires to do it again, is what you're saying, or are you saying?
No, do you think it made it feel safer or saner or more reasonable to go off and try to make this movie under the circumstances that you kind of know? Because there does seem to be a support system. There seems to be, you know, I get a lot of stuff from down under, from New Zealand. But I get stuff about the 24-hour film programs, and I get, you know, the different things that have been going on in there, and the theaters that are being rebuilt, and all the things that are kind of, there seems to be a very healthy film community, more so than most cities in America, including Los Angeles, Frankfurt. And it does seem like there is a kind of a group encouragement, like there's a sense that there is a community.
I think there's a tightness about it because it's a small country, and it's a tight community. And I think the hammock helps, absolutely. I mean, that's why we shot it there, because it's great. Everybody was a supporter. I mean, even in other locations, the farmers were like, come on and have a cup of tea and go and have a look. Yeah, if you want to shoot there, that's great, no problem. Mm-hmm. So there's not a lot of red tape there. I guess it's not answering your hammock question, though.
I think absolutely. I think what really happens in Wellington in particular, because that's where we live and that's our experience there, just that people are really willing to help out on everybody else's project, because you know that they will jump in just as happily on your project down the line, and there's a real, people are just happy to be making stuff and helping other people make stuff, and there's a real support network in that sense, definitely. And I think, you know, even within the film industry, people who are working it in their day jobs, you know, everybody's doing stuff on the weekends, and I think there's just a real sense of, maybe there's a sense of isolation of being on the other side of the world, that, you know, you're kind of like, well, we have to make stuff because, you know, it's not just going to come here and land on our lap, which in some ways, you know, the big films are, but you know, from a, you know, on a personal level for each individual, I think there is a sense of that, and that there's a real sense of creativity that comes from being a little bit cut off almost from, not cut off, but, you know, like removed from the rest of the world in some ways. And I think that community thing has really, has really developed. And then people just willing to help out each other. And
it's a very, it's a very different, system here. You really feel the system when you come here for the first time. Like it's very much, you know, the studio says what they want. And then, you know, then a whole lot of people, like a whole plethora of people go out and try and make that happen.
Right.
And it's, for over there, we sort of, you know, no one sort of said that. There's not that the infrastructure isn't there, so which is good, because it's just really, there's a whole lot of people there that are just there focused on the craft, because you know, that's why they go there. They don't go there for any other reason but to make movies. So the people that are making movies there are there to do that. And so I remember actually coming back from LA the first time and feeling really like, wow, there's a really, really strong current of talent here. And there's not a lot of peripheral sort of stuff. It's right, you know, that's the focus. And you really feel the sense of people there just to get on with it. And so, I felt like, I mean, obviously the story's got a unique angle and things like that. I never felt like anyone would be concerned about whether that would be, what's the word? Not appropriate, but, you know, like whether...
marketable,
I
suppose. It's interesting what he's saying just about that peripheral stuff, which is interesting because there's positive and negative with that. I think there's a real element of, you know, in New Zealand you can make the stuff, but then what? You know, how do you get it out to the world? There's not that side of stuff. I don't think has developed that much in New Zealand yet, and I think you know, here in the States, it's just phenomenal systems in place and great people and companies doing, you know, that, knowing innately how to, you know, reach an audience and how to make, you know, do all that. And I think that's something that New Zealand really doesn't have at the moment, or not that I know of, anyway. So I think I don't know. There's with the big, you know, comes a lot of that really good stuff too, with the big system in place. So it's interesting. I think it's just different, and I think that New Zealand's, having that smaller thing means that it is more insular, but then you get those negatives from the other side. So, I don't know, it's a really interesting question though.
I think, you know, our experience is quite different from a traditional, like a lot of New Zealand films. Generally, they come through the government funding body, so they've sort of, they've got sort of a political stance. Right. Slant, so to speak, because it's, you know, it's funded by taxpayers. It's got a certain criteria, whereas we were completely independent of that, so we could make what we wanted to make. Hence, we made a Western, which is, you know, not really sort of a traditional.
So, did you think about government funding, or did you just write it off and figure that's not going to happen because I'm making a different kind of movie?
Yeah, basically that. We did at one stage, sort of have a chat to them after we'd shot it and we cut it, and we realized we needed more money and stuff like that, but. From the outset, we didn't know.
Yeah.
We just thought they wouldn't go for it.
And has New Zealand changed enormously in terms of, you were talking about feeling kind of disconnected from the rest of the world. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think I was there 15 years ago, something like that, and it did feel like a little separate from the rest of the world.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, the internet has grown a lot since then, and, satellites and everything else. Does it feel like, do you guys feel the change in just your lives and your work?
Absolutely, an incredible change. It's really... It's the feeling of going to being this... I mean, I remember being a boy and watching a guy going around Venice Beach, California, interviewing people, asking if they knew where New Zealand was, and it was like... it was just... Nobody knew. Nobody knew anything about it. And so lots changed. There's a lot of factors with that. I mean, I think Lord of the Rings played a big part in that, and there was Flight of the Conchords that came through as well, that built awareness. I mean, everybody I meet now goes, New Zealand, Flight of the Conchords, or Lord of the Rings. It's one of those two things.
Yeah.
And...
Sheep.
Yeah. There's no more sheep anymore. How do you want to make...
Their sheep are gone, right?
No, the sheep are still there, but people don't...
But not as much. I think we've lost a lot of sheep. Anyway.
To Flight of the Conchords.
Yeah. But I guess the point is, like, it feels almost like we're just another suburb of the world now. We're not really like an isolated country. So we just, with Skype and things like that, it's not like an email. It's not like
so has that made the country more political or less political? Because I know when I was there, it was all about keeping nukes out and all that kind of stuff. Was still a very hot topic.
No, I still like it quite a bit.
I don't know.
Mm. We've been making a movie the last 6 years. We actually haven't been that involved in anything.
If the question is, does it make Kiwis less staunch, I'd say no. I'd say they're still staunch Kiwis. But I think that there's a feeling like we're part of the world community now instead of sort of like an island down the bottom of the world.
And specifically in a film level, you get the, you know, like what Peter Jackson and Richard Taylor and Jeremy Selkirk have done down there is basically created an industry that wasn't there before. And it just made it possible. I mean, you know, like you were saying.
Yeah, like I was saying, I didn't think I could because it just wasn't reality. Right. Now it's a reality. Everything's there and it's really, really done really, really well. So it's an awesome place to make movies. It's really great.
So was there a hardest part or most surprising part as you went through this journey that you didn't really see coming?
Wow.
The edit, probably. Would you say the edit?
Yeah. Well, I think mainly because the edit took quite a long time. I mean, there were moments of sort of, you know, peaking difficulty. But, probably the edit was the most sustained, difficult thing.
I would say, actually...
How long did you shoot?
Six weeks.
We did 3 weeks in the South Island. Uh-huh. And then we had 2 weeks of building a couple of seats in that. And then 3 weeks in the North Island. So 6 weeks in total.
So that's a pretty reasonable schedule, considering... Small
yeah, I mean, yeah, it was, you know, it was long days. but it was really good.
So what was the surprise in editing? I mean, obviously challenging always, but...
I would actually say the thing is, it's the overall sustain that you have to have, the overall commitment. That's the most challenging thing. It's the constantly just having to drive and having to keep going, just going, okay, no matter what. That would be the most challenging thing out of the whole thing. Not just the edit, but actually everything. And even now when you're sort of, we're like we've got distributors that are interested in that sort of stuff. Right. But just keeping on the money and just keep it, I mean keeping focused.
And making, prudent decisions at every point of the way.
And doing your best to be, because what happens is once people come on board, you become obligated to, you have a responsibility for them, for the commitment they've put into it. So you're holding the responsibility of all these people sort of in your hands. So you have to really, really be careful about what you do and what you decide because, you know, they've put so much of their creative energy into it. So it's doing that. I mean, you get used to it, but it's just sort of...
Probably another...
7 days a week.
Yeah, well, I think that was one of the biggest things is that we were both working full-time while making the film most of the time. We took 2 months off to actually shoot the film. Being contractors, that helped. So we took 2 months off to shoot the film, and then while doing the edit, we were still working full-time. So we'd basically go work a 10-hour day, come home, go into the edit suite.
We're digital at the time as well, so that
we're doing
big hours, so.
Film hours and then coming home, and then we'd go and have dinner, go into the edit suite, and then work till whatever time, midnight, 1 a.m. whatever, and then rinse and repeat. And then on the weekends we'd spend the full days editing both Saturday and Sunday, and that was for a year.
We had a particular thing that we were doing, a particular type of
system how
we
were doing it. Yeah,
how we were doing that. So it just took a really, really long time because we were only doing it at night.
Yeah.
And was there a moment where you said, we're not sure this is going to work, or we've got a problem here, or is it just we've got to somehow find enough hours in the day to get through this?
That was pretty much it. It was just finding the time. That was our biggest thing that we would say is just, we just want to be full-time on this. We just want to be full-time on this, because that's the biggest thing. So we weren't able to be full-time, but we had to create the full-time hours out of what you did in the day. And so I think that was the most challenging thing is working full-time throughout the whole project. And even now, I'm going back and I'm going to work, so it's just kind of that keeping paying the rent whilst doing something like this, and because you're putting everything into making the film, not obviously sustaining yourself.
So does this experience mean that you can't go back? I mean, obviously you've gone back on some level, but for the moment, but as you go on, do you have to make the next film, or are you that much more passionate about what you do next?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, definitely. I mean, it's an incredible experience. Since I was a teenager, like I said, I wanted to make movies. It's a long time you spend of your life dreaming about doing something. And then when you actually get to do it and fulfill it, and I mean, it's a lot more rewarding in different ways than you'd expect. Well, this is my experience anyway. I found it a lot more rewarding than I had imagined, but also a lot more challenging than I had. So it was sort of like just a more extreme, intense version of what I had dreamed. And when you do that, you're kind of left with the question, well, what would happen if I went further? Like, what would I do, if we could go further and more and have more interesting and incredible experiences? I mean, just sitting here, that never even came into my mind when I was dreaming about making movies, or going to Newport Beach or whatever, or... people that we've met, the things that we've done, and just really, really incredible experiences. And we had Leonard Maltin give us a great review, and I'm a big fan of Leonard Maltin because we watched him in New Zealand. It was one of the shows we had, Entertainment Tonight with Lisa Gibbons, back in the thing. It's like a familiar voice, and he came to our screening at Santa Barbara, and it was weird. You don't think about those things. There's so many added benefits for doing it, besides actually creating something that you're proud of, which we were lucky enough to do, that we were really proud of it. I mean, it would be a different story if we came out and we're like, oh my God.
what have we done?
But right from that first shot and going, this is going to work, everything has seemed to have worked with it. And we've just tried to make the best decisions to go with that. And even like we had an experience where we had a cut done earlier because we'd had some editing experiences with other editors that didn't work out, and we had a first cut, and I watched it and I was like, this is not the movie that's in my head. And I knew it was in my head because I knew the takes that I'd said, we've got it. So I knew that they were all there, and it was just a case of getting it together. And then when I saw that first cut, I was like, this is not the film, we're going to start again. And so that was probably one of the hardest times, was seeing the first cut and getting up and just going, and having faith that
knowing it was in there, but then having to go and
we've got to restart.
Well, every director's first, every time they see the first cut, is when they want to commit suicide. Every movie, no matter how experienced the director, the first cut makes them want to jump off a bridge.
But I consider we had two first cuts. We had that first cut, which was terrible, started again, then we had another first cut, and it was like that first cut that was just like, this is not the movie.
So this time maybe a nice urban romantic comedy about a couple wants to buy a house?
In one room.
No, man.
No, we're getting big out there.
Get outside, man. It's beautiful. I'm like, we've been inside way too long.
Yeah. That's true. Yeah, we've been in post-production for the last, however long. We want to be outside again. Yeah. No, actually, I think, we had so many really amazing moments. We were on set. You're standing in the middle of nowhere and you're just going, this is a pretty incredible business. You know, the fact that, you know, we're standing here shooting with, you know, all this stuff, and just, it's just, it's such a unique experience making a film. There's a magic
especially,
about it.
Especially when you're not paying anyone, because everyone's there on a belief. They're not getting paid, so they just believe that this is, you're going to create something out of nothing and it's going to be good. And when you sort of really, like, we went to really isolated locations, mm-hmm. and you sort of get those overwhelming moments where you're just like, this is really incredible. Everybody's there for a common purpose, but that common purpose isn't real yet.
Yeah.
So when the guy comes with a $10 million check, you're going to tell him to go away. You don't really want it. You're just going to bootstrap it.
No. Next time, however, we'd definitely be paying the crew.
Next time, we want to do it again so we can actually pay the great crew that we had. We had an amazing crew. They're just awesome. Just absolutely top notch. And so it would be really great to do another one and actually pay them. So we all can go out there and, like...
This time around, we fed them really well. That was the way we had to feed everybody really well.
My sister and brother-in-law were the caterers. Yeah.
It was a family affair.
Yeah.
And so...
Which they did an amazing job. Yeah. Big job feeding that sort of large group of people.
Yeah.
Excellent.